When people ask, "What are you feeling?" they could be referring to tactile sensations. We feel when our hands touch an object or when something brushes against our arms. Or they could mean, "How much pain are you experiencing and where is it located?" But when the topic of feelings is general, they're referring to emotions. Emotion is a category of stimuli. It is not a single entity. There is not one emotion or one emotional center. You might think of an emotion as a stimulus that has high significance. When we are experiencing stimuli with low significance, we don't perceive any emotion. We would say we aren't feeling anything. But when we feel something, we notice it. It has significance to us. It stands out. Although the significance is obviously subjective, emotion also indicates a high level of arousal. We have strong feelings. Sometimes emotions are so strong they seem overwhelming. We compare them to natural disasters. We imagine them as giant waves, avalanches, or earthquakes. We say they flood us, bury us, or shake us to our roots. Also like natural disasters, emotions are quick, automatic, and outside of our control. They happen suddenly, without warning. There's no need to wait for them or schedule a time for their appearance. We instantly feel surprise. We automatically grin from ear to ear. Tears just appear. For speedy response, emotions are hardwired. They are built in. But it's more complicated than seeing than perceiving. It's not that straightforward. For some reason, you can feel more than one emotion at a time. You can be happy sad. You can be happy scared. And unfortunately, you can be sad, scared, angry, disgusted, all at the same time. Some have tried to classify emotions on two dimensions. There is the pleasant-unpleasant continuum, and the low-to-high level of activation or arousal. But deciding that you have lots of strong, unpleasant sensations doesn't really lead you very far. Others have tried to specify exactly what emotions exist. Unfortunately, there is no agreement as to what constitutes basic emotions. Everyone has their own collection, but the most commonly included are fear, surprise, anger, happiness, and sadness. The cast of characters is uncertain because our knowledge of the underlying process is uncertain. We know that the sympathetic nervous system arouses emotions, and the parasympathetic nervous system soothes them. We know that fear correlates with a decrease in body temperature. So when you're afraid to commit to something, the colloquial, "you've got cold feet," might actually be true. Similarly, an increase in skin temperature, getting hot under the collar, is often associated with anger. But cause and effect are difficult to nail down. Does the emotion cause the change in temperature? Do we interpret the temperature as a change in emotion? Or are both caused by some other factor? Brainwise, the amygdala is often cited as critical to understanding emotions. These nuclei are located toward the base of the brain, next to the hippocampus. The amygdala helps us evaluate the significance of stimuli and aids in the generation of emotional responses. There's a lot more to be learned about the amygdala, or perhaps it should be amygdalae, because there are two of them, one in each cerebral hemisphere. For example, why are there two centers for emotional connection when we only perceive emotion as a single entity? When we feel two feelings, is each amygdala generated one? How do they interconnect and talk to each other? We know these areas of the brain become active when we feel strong emotions, and they generate hormones which could have wide-ranging effects, but they might be more involved in the recognition of emotion than its generation. Damage to the amygdala regions causes psychic blindness, the inability to recognize fear in facial expressions. The amygdala is so deep in the brain that it's difficult to damage it without impacting other structures, but bilateral damage to the amygdala region can result in major disruptions. In the Caprust delusion, there's a disconnect between seeing an item and your emotional connection to it. Your father or mother might seem like imposters. They look like your parents, but you don't feel the emotional connection you usually do. Your vision system works, but there's no emotional response. Caprust is a rare and temporary condition. Apparently, the nerve fibers need to reestablish the link between our visual system and our emotional reaction system. Given some time, the links are reestablished and the delusion goes away. When you see a painting, hear a song, or feel a hug, you process the actual event as it occurs and form an emotional reaction. I hate that painting. I love that song. Ooh, Aunt Mary's hugging me. So it's clear that thinking and feeling are not the same, but they are connected. We sense and think. Then the emotional response impacts other parts of the body. We stiffened Aunt Mary's embrace. We swayed to the song. We frowned in the painting. We are quite expressive.